Hello, everybody. Are you all settled in? Cool. So we have a speaker. His name's Sean Cross. I think he's more commonly known as Zobs. And his background is he's moved from software development, I understand, and now has gone closer to hardware and into manufacturing and testing primarily. Works on the hardware firmware at Chumbi, and that's where he first learned about manufacturing, and now he's currently based in Singapore.
Mm-hmm.
Great. And today he's going to be talking about mass production, open source testing, and manufacturing. All right, take it away.
Thank you, and thank you everybody for coming out today on public holiday. It's the last day. It's the last talk of the last day of LinuxConf. Everybody been enjoying their conference so far?
Yeah.
Well, it's actually rather appropriate that we have a talk on testing in the last speaker slot of LinuxConf, because testing is usually the last thing that you do in a product before you ship it off to customers. And so this talk is going to be on a project that we've developed in Kosagi in Singapore called Xclave, that you can use to very quickly come up with tests. Now, an outline of what this talk is going to be about, first I'm just going to give some background as to what we've done and what motivated this. Then I'm going to go through just some slides of visiting a factory, because everybody loves slides of visiting a factory. Then I'm going to go into a history of testers that we've done before Xclave. And again, this is just motivating what caused us to design it the way we did. Then I'll give some real-life examples of ways we've used this software, products that have used Xclave in the past. And then I'll just go over a little bit of some of the internals, things you can do, things we haven't done with it yet. And then I'll talk about some tips and tricks that you can use when you're building a factory test. Now, if you're watching this on the stream or you're going back to see it after, you're probably going to be most interested in step six, or in part six, the tips and tricks. Because that's just generally applicable to anybody. It's not particular to Xclave, but I think these are important enough rules that I put it in there at the very end, just to kind of guide people who are new to the whole testing section. So start up with the background. Like you said in the introduction, I used to work for a company called Chumbi. I first joined there in 2008, and this is my first foray into hardware and firmware, really. When I joined in 2008, the Chumbi Classic was this old guy. It was one of the first open hardware projects, but I didn't actually get into hardware until the Chumbi One. And my first time visiting Shenzhen, which is where all of this tends to be built, it's a lot of hardware in the world comes from Shenzhen, was 2009. And that was my first time learning what a factory does and learning how they take the components together and assemble them. And I hadn't even heard of a factory test before then. And I have since learned that everything needs a factory test. So every piece of electronics in here, every thing that comes out of a factory needs some sort of factory test. And every feature on the board needs to be individually tested. These are four different products we've done in Singapore since Chumbi. There's the first one up there is the Coven robot controller board. There's the Novena open source laptop. Bunny talked yesterday about the Chibi chip. That's the thing in the orange block. And then there's the Tomu USB drive that I think most people got one inside the pack. Each one of these has had a factory test that has tested every single feature, every single component that has gone into the product. And when you're designing a product, the tests are always the last thing you think of. I mean, it's the same way in software, right? You're just trying to get the thing done. You don't have time to write tests. And that's completely okay, because when you're designing a product, the chips you use, the features you use, might be changing throughout the product. You may switch accelerometers because the one you want is no longer available. And so it doesn't make sense to create a specific test for that accelerometer, because by the time you're manufacturing it, that part may no longer be available. And the thing is, every test is unique. So every product that gets tested has a unique way of testing it. This is an example that I found in a factory that was testing outdoor LED signs. The orange box there is a factory test jig. And I'm not entirely sure what it did, but they had a big wall with a giant power supply, and a guy would basically sit there the entire day with this being bathed in these bright lights. And they were doing that to make sure that the LED filaments worked. They had to test every single element before it went out. Just to drive the point home, you need 100% coverage. If there's a feature, it needs to be tested. So for a mobile phone like this, the factory test system is going to be very extensive. They need to test the GPS, they need to test the accelerometer, the barometer, they need to test the screen, they have a minimum number of acceptable dead pixels. It can be very extensive. They actually need to characterize the antenna. It can take a long time. I saw one where it was at a phone factory, and they had this thing that they put the phone in. It looked like a little coffin, really. And it had fingers that came around, and it put things in all the ports, and it dragged it into a box. It programmed the firmware. It tested all the RF characterization. This box cost about $1 million each to build. But you look next to it, and there were just 400 empty seats because this one box had replaced all the humans who previously had to poke the screen and interact with it. So getting 100% coverage can be really, really difficult. And when I say everything has a factory test, I mean everything. This is a Casio watch that somebody put in factory test mode where it turns on all the elements on the screen to make sure that the screen works. And so one of the reasons why you'd want to go to a factory is to see what their capabilities are, see if they have the ability to design these tests and see what their engineers are familiar with. And so with that, let's just very quickly go over what visiting a factory entails. When you get to the factory, it's a long flight, and by the time you get there, you're greeted with something that looks like this. It's a gleaming, wide open space, lots of machines everywhere making very loud noises. There's going to be a section on the side where all the parts are kept. But let's go through actually one of the Chibitronics test lines. It starts out, you get the stencils. And these are basically sheets of metal that have holes in them where the solder paste goes. The stencils go on this machine. It puts it down. This little thing applies solder paste. It squeezes it along. It looks like this. You can see the holes where the solder paste goes. Then it goes on these rails, and it goes into all the machines. The machines take reels of components. The components come on reels. And they slot them into the side of the machine, and they program them. And you either get a pick and place like this that picks the components up. It scans it across to do optical recognition, then it puts it down. This is for the larger and microcontrollers. This is for things that are too big to put in a chip shooter. If that's not fast enough and your components are small enough, you can use a chip shooter like this that has a whole bunch of heads. It loads them up, it brings the board in, and it just knocks them down. These things make a fantastic sound, and they're so fast. But you need only the small components can be done with a chip shooter. For the bigger ones, they'll just fly right off. And the thing is, all of these machines have to be programmed, and generally the factory will program them. And this is an example of what the programming looks like. It's all in Chinese. So when you go there, you're really at the mercy of the factory. You really need to be on their good side and work with them, not against them. So don't come up with, this is the way it will be done, there's no changing it. If the factory has a preferred way of doing something, actually visiting the factory allows you to interact with them and get a better sense of how to more efficiently run your factory test and put your products, the components on the board, and just get a better experience for both you and the factory. So after these machines, you put it in an oven like this, bake it 220 degrees for about 12 minutes, and afterwards your board comes out. You get a whole big stack of them like this, and then you break for lunch. And then you have to test it to make sure that it was put together right. Because, you know, that chip shooter, that's pretty rough. And it might be that it rotated a piece sideways, or maybe something didn't get, maybe you need to adjust the reflow temperature. You need to run a factory test. So now I'm going to go through a brief history of product tests that I've been involved with. I mentioned earlier that the Chumby one, this guy, was the first time that I'd ever visited a factory. I didn't actually do the test. I spoke last night with a guy who did do the test, and so I got some pictures back. The test was written entirely in Flash. And that's because the Chumby was a small device that played Flash widgets. So it tested all the hardware. It tested everything from the touchscreen to the battery to the accelerometer to the speakers. So we actually had at one point, it played a very bass-heavy sound on battery under the theory that the bass would drain more current than a big, you know, a nice high-frequency type thing. This test took about 1.5 months to develop. And one of the big problems with it is that if there was a failure, it stopped the whole test. So one of the tests was Wi-Fi. And as I'm sure everyone here knows, Wi-Fi can be very finicky. It might not connect, it might disconnect, especially if the guy downstairs is doing magnetizing speaker coils, which generates a lot of EMF that makes it particularly difficult. And so the test looked like this. Like I said, the only he gave me the Shockwave Flash file, and the only thing I had that could open SWF files was Internet Explorer. So this is screen one. It happened to run on Windows. Fortunately, this test could detect when it wasn't running on a Chumby, and it went into kind of a cheater mode that was easier to get through. But it started just telling you the version of the Flash player, and then you're supposed to touch the red circles. Interestingly enough, the first two are complete dummies, because when you're calibrating a resistive touchscreen, you just need two corners. And then the operator had to go there and squeeze the top five times. Remember, an operator had to do all this. They have to pick it up and actually touch the screen. Then they had to move a ball around to test the accelerometer. Apparently, the factory workers loved that because it was kind of fun because you got to move a ball around. So if you can, make the tests fun. Because if humans have to do it, make the test fun. Make it so that their life is a little bit better. Then they had to turn it upside down, and that was, I think, to make sure that the accelerometer wasn't placed in a funny position or the board didn't come disconnected. And then I got to step six, which is where it tries to connect to Wi-Fi, which didn't work so well in my browser. So Chumby won 1.5 months to develop. When I moved to Singapore, we worked on this robot controller board called Covan. Initially, I did all the testing in C, but then I realized that C doesn't really have a very good user interface, so we did a port to Qt. We had a cheat mode that you could enable when you tapped certain areas on, or when you clicked certain areas of the test screen, that would let you retest particular components. So if the Wi-Fi test was failing and they went and reworked the Wi-Fi card, we can jump directly to that test and retest the Wi-Fi. One problem is that because it was a GUI that was done in C++, it was difficult to compile because you needed a special cross-compiling toolchain and a special compiled version of libqt. Also, we hard-coded the test sequence. So if we decided that we wanted to move the Wi-Fi test earlier because it failed and you wanted to fail fast, you had to recompile the whole thing. And this thing took also about 1.5 months to develop. The tests looked like this. This is an example of the first test, the C version. You can see there's functions like harness info, return zero when it's success, return non-zero when it failed. You could put debug messages out and the harness would kind of pick those up. When we ported it to Qt, we decided that we were going to run each test in its own thread. That's because when you write tests, you do horrible things like long blocking that don't work so well with the GUI. And you could see one interesting trick here is that we actually have ifdefs here. So you can develop it on one system and just kind of stub out the actual test code, because otherwise you need to be running this test on real hardware. And so for this one, we hooked up the Qt based, they have an eventing system. For Novena, we reused the Qt framework from Covan. We didn't have the C based one. We start directly with C++. This one, we actually had three separate builds because for Novena, we had the base board. We had it integrated with a laptop case,
and then we had a desktop model without a battery. And again, it's just really difficult to write tests because you need a special compiler, and it took 3 months to develop this whole thing. And so this is, again, the battery testing code. If you have very eagle eyes, you'll notice that there's no closed curly brace there. That's because this function is really, really long, because it's a very complicated test. But one thing that I started to do here is this function, get gas gauge data, is actually speaking directly to the chip. It's going over I squared C to talk to the gas gauge data. It's not using the operating system. So we're not using the drivers that are part of Linux here, because there are a lot of registers in the chip that don't have driver exposure. And when you're doing testing, you want access to those. You don't necessarily want to have time to write a driver to speak to this one weird register that you might not use during normal production. And so here's an example of us starting to realize that maybe the testing using the drivers is not the right way to go. Also, just to kind of round out, we did a board called Fernvale, and this was basically a mobile phone chip that we put that we're trying to see if it worked at all. This thing just left field. It was just a UDEV script that loaded firmware on there just to make sure it worked. It had none of the other logging stuff, no GUI or anything like that. I did the entire test with a Raspberry Pi plugged into a battery pack. It wasn't very big, but all of these approaches have problems. They all required a custom compiler. They had a non-uniform UI, either an LCD screen in the case of the Novena, or HDMI in the case of the Coven, or Chumby One had its little internal screen. There was no standard logging mechanism at all, and it's difficult to port between projects. I ended up doing a lot of search and replace. But more importantly, it was difficult to create tests, because you need to compile them, you need to write them in a particular language. I've seen tests that are written in Python, and some people love Python, some people hate Python. I've seen tests written in Node, I've seen tests written in Forth. There's a guy who wrote an entire test suite in Forth. The guy loved Forth. Not many other people know how to write Forth. And so it's difficult to get other people to come on board and help you with the tests. As the guy who's doing the test infrastructure, you can't go to the hardware guy and say, hey, can you help me write a test? Because they might not know how to use your particular programming language. And so, armed with the knowledge of these failures, I decided to come up with this program called Xclave. And this is what it looks like. Let me first show you what Xclave has done, and then I'll tell you more about Xclave from an implementer's perspective. People had a chance to see the Tomu jig out by the Great Hall. Tomu runs Xclave. It tests the MCU, so it tries to talk to it using OpenOCD, and it blinks the LEDs. This test jig was actually created in a few hours. What happened was I landed in the city in China at about 5 p.m., and then I met them at the airport, and they had the test jig there. And I was like, great, I'm going to go back to the hotel room and write the test. And they said, okay, let's get dinner. So I got dinner with them, and then I had to take it back to the hotel. And overnight, because we were running mass production the next day, I had to create the test jig. But with Xclave and previous projects, it was easy enough to put something together that the next day, 8 a.m., we show up at the factory and we run 1,000 Tomu boards. Chibi Chip, which Bunny talked about yesterday, its tester is a little bit more complicated. We decided to automate everything. And I decided to do this after I was looking at the tester for a couple of hours. And when you're testing LEDs, and you have to stare at the LED to figure out if it works, you start getting spots in your vision. And I didn't want to subject the workers to that. So we decided to automate everything. We had Bunny do a small PCB with a light sensor that would count the pulse width modulation signals. And we had a little servo for the reset button. And pulse width modulation, if you want to fade an LED, just kind of a background, you just turn it on and off really quickly. And if you have a pulse detector, you can count every time this pulse turns on. And if the light isn't working, it doesn't turn out at all. And so using this, you can automate everything. And I just want to kind of show you how this test works. You plug it in like that. They close the lid. They push the start button, exactly like the Tomu tester. It presses the reset button using this little servo. then it loads the operating system over SWD, then it loads the test program over audio to test the audio, then it tests the serial port, then it tests the RGB LED, flashes it, then it tests the external one, using this little pulse sensor to figure out if it's been pulsed. And we do the RGB LED separately because during reflow, if there's moisture in the air, it'll actually crack the sensor. Then it tests each LED individually. Now it's doing a connectivity test. And finally, it loads the final program on. You can see the light blinking. And then it's done. And for this particular test, we actually have one more thing that it does. It prints out a coupon that is a unique number for that particular device. And so this all was done using Xclave. And the thing is, it's probably comparable in terms of functionality to that $1 million tester, but we did this just on a shoestring budget with a bunch of shell scripts slapped together. And it's the kind of thing that you could... It's reproducible, it logs, it does everything we needed. One interesting thing about that about the RGB LED, it's a model number called WS2812B. And because we're counting the number of pulses, one of the things we do is we make sure that it was about 400 kilohertz, because that's what the rate at which it turns on and off, 400 times per second. We got a call from the factory saying, hey, we got a new batch of these lights in, and none of them are working. And we said, oh, that's weird. And I said, but the old ones work just fine. They're more difficult to get, they're a little bit more expensive, but we can do a run with the old ones, but we should figure out what's wrong with the new ones. And we found this production upgrade notice without changing the model number, without even really telling most of their customers. They changed the part from 400 hertz to 2 kilohertz. And it's the kind of thing that normally you wouldn't notice, but because we are counting these pulses and because we're characterizing it this way, our first assumption was that they had gotten a batch of clones because it wasn't the same thing that we were getting before. And so by characterizing it this way, we actually kind of protect ourselves against people who don't have completely exact clones. Unfortunately, we're also protecting ourselves against the vendor changing their characterization, but, you know, whatever. So we flew out there, we fixed it, and now it actually accepts either one. But perhaps the biggest victory is Bunny did a badge for his camp in Burning Man 2017. And I'd actually just got this photo on Wednesday because Bunny, a hardware engineer, managed to put together an entire test jig himself in about 4 hours to test the Burning Man badge. And to get a hardware guy, to enable a hardware guy to put together a tester as the guy who normally writes the tests, that's less work for me, so that's great. But it also enables him to add tests and generally make his product better because he knows what to test for. He knows which parts are going to be difficult to solder. So by letting the hardware guy do the test software, everyone comes away happier. So I'm going to go over some of the internals now. Like I've been talking about Xclave this whole time. What is it? The architecture is, it's written in Rust, but that doesn't matter because none of the tests need to be written in Rust. Everything in Xclave is a subprocess. And we use standard I/O for communication. So the number one principle in Xclave is standard I/O is great. Standard I/O reigns supreme. Kind of think CGI. So an example of a test that would pass is just this. This invokes binsh, echoes hello world. And so for this test, it would exit. It would pass because it exits zero. The result of this test would be hello world, and there would be one log message that comes out, hello world. An example of a failing test would look like this. It would echo the message, checking response. Then the result of the test would be, world didn't say hello back, and it would exit one. And that's because the last thing that got printed before it returned is world didn't say hello back. And we do this because hardware bring up is unique. Like, this is an example out of a data sheet that I have. This is how you're supposed to program this particular chip. They don't necessarily give you a bunch of registers. At the end, they do have a list of registers, but they say when you want to get this chip working, follow this flowchart, jam these registers in this value, or jam this value in this register. And this is completely normal. This is how hardware people work. They don't care about macros that define values for registers and things like that. They just give me a pointer and a value to put in that pointer, and I'm happy. And so when you first get the hardware, this is what you do. You come up with bash scripts that jam values into registers, and then that stays with you for the entire lifetime of the project until you get around to writing a driver. And this thing, this shell script, this Python script, this whatever, that just jams values into registers, this is really well tested because it lives for the entire lifetime of the product. For the Novena laptop, we had this. This is how we tested the accelerometer. We just jammed this value into register 16, enabled the accelerometer, and they do a dump from a range, register 6 through 8. And it seemed to work. It seemed to actually read values back. And what more do you need? You don't need to write a driver. You don't need to read from sys dev input accelerometer. You just need to read the registers back, and that's good enough to see that the accelerometer chip is working. Additionally, a lot of times in the documentation, they have registers that do things that you don't normally want to write a driver for. This is a snippet from an embedded display port chip, and it has this register here for the pattern generator. Now, a pattern generator will spit there's actually a bunch of things. There's red, green, blue. There's the standard color bars. This is built into the display port chip, and you can have that drive a screen with a particular pattern. This is not the sort of thing you'd really want to write in your driver, but if you just write directly to the register, you can get this functionality. So even if the other side of the bridge isn't working, you can make sure the screen works. So again, by just randomly generating, or by being able to jam values into registers and wrap that in a shell script and have that be a test, Xclave thinks that that is the way to go. Xclave, in addition to tests, supports scenarios. Now, a scenario might look like this. It's a list of tests. In this case, it does a program OS and then uploads a test program and then finishes the tests. Tests support dependencies, and so this will automatically resolve dependencies. But interestingly enough, if a test depends on another one, then the previous test must pass before a test will run. Remember earlier I was talking about the Chumby one where the Wi-Fi test would fail and the entire thing would stop working. It may be that there are two things that need testing and reworking. And so if the entire test stops after Wi-Fi and the speaker doesn't work, then when the worker sees the Wi-Fi test has failed, they'll go and they'll rework the board, bring it back. Wi-Fi test will fail, or will pass, but the speaker test will fail, and so they go need to rework it a second time. But there's no reason why we can't test the speaker if the Wi-Fi fails. They're completely orthogonal. So Xclave will try and test as much as it can before finishing the test and letting you get back to reworking the board. If you do have a problem component, if you're in the factory and you discover that a particular component fails a lot of the time, what you can do is you can set up a separate side station that only runs that one test. So I mentioned earlier the RGB LED is particularly problematic, and it's actually really difficult to rework. So when somebody wants to pull it off and put a new one on, there's a chance that the hot air reflow gun that they use might damage the chip. And so they wanted a test that just checks that. And an example of doing something like that would be this, where we actually don't even need to rerun the burn OS. We don't need to rerun the burn testing program, because that's already in there. We know the test failed because the test ran. And so Xclave supports having scenarios that are just abbreviated things that assume that other tests, such as programming the OS, have completed. You can also see here that the timeout is really short because there's no reason for this test to take 5 minutes. It's just running some commands and blinking an LED. Xclave also supports loggers. Don't worry, it's not binary loggers. We don't write binary log files. We write text because everyone loves text, right? And this is what a logger looks like. It gets this on standard in. There are various columns here, what generated the test, what time it was generated, and what the actual message is. We don't specify a log format, though, because in China, so the first instinct people have is to send it over the network somewhere. But in China, first off, the network might not exist, or it might not be very good. But more importantly, the factory you're in might not have a good network connection, possibly because somebody is torrenting something or possibly because it just isn't working for the day. But you can't guarantee that you're going to have a network connection. You need some other way to log the data. And so because of this, we have the concept of loggers, where you can just plug whatever logger you want in, or plug multiple loggers in if you want. So I kind of have plans in the future for something that logs to a write-only memory type thing, like a spinor that they mail back at the end, or possibly broadcasting it to a network. There's lots of options here. But the point about loggers is they are pluggable and exchangeable. And if you don't like tab-separated values, we also do JSON. Interfaces, I want to tell a little bit about interfaces. If anybody is interested in this project and knows anything about Bootstrap or something, they want to make a more beautiful web interface. This is an example of a web interface that I wrote. It speaks standard in and standard out, so it talks to Exclave through standard I.O. It's bidirectional. It can do anything that the tester, you can run individual tests, you can switch scenarios, you can see the logs. But it doesn't have to, an interface doesn't have to implement all the features. When you go to a factory, you'll see something like this. This is all the pick and place machines and all the chip shoes and things like that. But if you look closely, you'll notice that all of the machines have these red, yellow, green traffic lights on top. And that's because the factory workers, they might not be able to, they almost certainly won't be able to understand English. They might understand the words pass and fail. But they won't. They want to be able to very easily, at a glance, know if something is operating or failing or in the process of testing. So let's see if we can't recreate that as a sample interface in Exclave. This is actually almost the entire way to implement these three LEDs. It's just a bash script reading from standard in and piping it through grep. If a message comes in at start, it knows that the test is starting and it turns on the yellow light. If the fail comes in, that means a test failed, and so also turn on the yellow red light. If the word finish comes across, then it contains a three-digit HTTP style code between 2 and 300, turn the green light on because you passed, hooray. Otherwise, turn the red light on. And like I said, this is the code. If you've seen the Tomu tester, this is what's running on these lights. When I got to LCA, I actually had to label them because I know people who aren't familiar with factories might not realize that that's what these three things are. But in the factory, they will know what the red, yellow, and green lights mean in the context of testing. As an example of somebody not necessarily realizing this, there are some people who build products in China using AVRs, and they use AVR dude to upload code. They said, yeah, just run this command on a Windows machine, and if it says that it fails somewhere in the text, reject the chip. And the worker there had no idea what the word fail meant. He had no idea to read the AVR dude output. He had no idea how to do any of this. They had to end up wrapping it around something else. But with Exclave, it's wrapped for you automatically. You just have to create these LEDs, and then it's a familiar interface to the factory workers. So with that in mind, I'm going to go over just some tips and tricks. So if you find yourself in a factory writing tests, these are things to keep in mind. First off, it's better to overspec and look at more values than less. So check every single version code in every single chip. We checked some version codes in an FPGA at one point, and it's because we were binning them in terms of whether it's a 45K gate or a 9K gate, and there were about five chips that came out of that that they didn't program at all. And we looked at them, and it's because the JTAG codes that we're reading out of there were pre-production, not for sale silicon that somehow made its way onto our parts. If we hadn't checked the version codes, we wouldn't have known it, because they program just as well as everything else. But by checking all the version codes, we caught that problem, and we were able to address it and disqualify that vendor from the factory and characterize if possible. So for the RGB LED, we were able to characterize the pulse width and know whether or not a particular chip is authentic or not. But at the same time, don't take too long. And that's because time is money, and the longer your test takes, the more it costs to run the test. Generally, they quote the test time in terms of how much time a worker spends in front of the machine. And the worker, if there's a long period of boredom, they might get bored and watch the local Chinese equivalent of YouTube. And so if you're testing multiple units at once, because that's one way to scale it out, I've seen cases where when one test fails, it just kind of sits there, and the worker forgets about it because it doesn't say pass. And so they go from having 10 testers down to 9, down to 8, down to 7. And they had to address this fact. They had to make it obvious when the test failed. So make sure that the worker, talk to the worker, figure out what they're doing, so to make sure the test doesn't take too long. Another thing that I'm personally a big fan of is Raspberry Pis. They're fantastic. They're everywhere. You can get them in the middle of nowhere, China. They're very easy to scale up because you just copy an SD card and now you have two copies. There's a great piece of software out there called Pi Blaster that does stupid DMA tricks to get PWM out an arbitrary pin or pins. And if you want to program an ARM device, OpenOCD, you can actually literally just wire from pins 23 and 25 to the clock and data pins on your target device. There's no wires. So for that chibi chip tester, there are not even passive components. It's just wires from the Raspberry Pi header to the test jig. So Raspberry Pis are great. However, if you do a Raspberry Pi thing, mount slash as read-only. And that has to do, I think it's a bug with how Linux interacts with SD cards. Factory workers treat the test jig as an appliance. And so it's appliance they're working on. And so every time they go to rework it, they'll pull out their soldering iron and flip the power off. And if slash is not mounted as read-only, I think what's going on is the instant at which the power goes away, it tries to write a log message to the disk, and then that corrupts the boot sector, and then you end up with a disk after about 5 or 6 tries that no longer boots. And you can't instruct the workers to push this button to do a shutdown sequence and all that. No, they're just going to turn it off. But if you mount slash as read-only, it will protect you against this. Similarly, load the test onto a USB drive. And we do this because it allows you to email a zip file with an updated version of the test to the factory. And they can plug that into their Windows PC, usually, and update the test that way. Make sure your test ignores line endings. Using a zip file can get around that because tar.gz will automatically do line ending conversion. And make sure the disk is formatted FAT. Never build a jig yourself. I've talked to people who really enjoy building jigs, and that's great, but it can take a lot of time. And this is the sort of thing that factories are good at. This is an example of the documentation that I gave to the factory. I have a picture of the board, a picture of the Raspberry Pi header, and a place where pin 1 is. And I say, connect this wire to here. And they were able to take this and actually built 4 different jigs that were all ready by the time we went to the factory to do testing, to do bring up. All I had to do was slot in the Raspberry Pi, and they were good to go. So never build a jig yourself unless you like doing that sort of thing. They will not provide you with the software. We had to provide them with the Raspberry Pi and the test jig software, but that's what Xclave's for, right? This is what it looks like. So you do not want to be debugging this mess of wires. They're good at debugging that mess of wires. You just want to slot your thing in there and have it work. Similarly, anytime you build a test jig, build at least 2. Leave one in the factory for when you do the next run. Bring one back yourself to your home country so that you can develop an updated test. You're going to end up having new firmware for it. You're going to modify the test. You're going to find components that fail that you want to test a little bit more. And so by having a test jig in your workshop at home, you can develop those updates and then create a zip file and send it to the factory. And later on, you can build a second run of them. And so that's it. That's what I've got. Questions? No, there's just shout it out.
Just a quick one. Thanks for your talk, Sean. Do you ever have issues with color blindness with the LEDs for operators?
Do we ever have any issues with color blindness with the operators? Surprisingly, no. The reason why colorblindness would be an issue is if they swapped the red and the green channels. And there is a person I'm aware of who is doing, they actually have a colorometer. They measure the frequency of the LEDs. We have never seen a case where the color elements are swapped. I mean, that's the sort of thing that could happen. But I don't like staring at LEDs, and so I try and make sure that the operators don't have to stare at LEDs either. It's not been an issue that we've run into, no.
How do you actually write tests on Xclave?
How do I write tests for Xclave? They're shell scripts. And so, they're not necessarily shell scripts. OpenOCD is an example of a test. And OpenOCD is just a C program that gets called. And it's a daemon test. And so what we do is we look for a particular string that gets printed out when it's attached successfully to the device. So OpenOCD is considered a test. Other things can talk to OpenOCD. And you might, for example, see a Python program that talks to the OpenOCD on localhost port 4444, or if it's the tickle port, 45555. Just write a Python program, exactly the same as you'd write from the shell script, from the bash prompt. Make it so that you can execute this test locally. And when you're done, specify it in Xclave. Xclave will do the exact same thing you do. It actually runs it inside a subshell with its own pseudo terminal. So it is going to run that command exactly the same way you do. So it doesn't matter how you write it. Write it however you like to do it best, and then just feed it into Xclave.
So it's not any kind of application.
Any kind of application will work. Just expects that when you're done, exit 0 if it's successful, exit non-0 if it's non-successful, and the last thing you print is considered the result.
Okay. So it allows anyone to program their own favorite language.
It allows you to program in your own favorite language, correct.
Cool. And I really wish I'd had this about 3 years ago when I was working with a hardware company in Canberra. How do you handle multiple tests that might use the same device? Say you've got a test to check that the touch screen is working and a test to check that the the accelerometer is working that displays something on the screen. Is there a way in Xclave to say these two tests use the same device or this set of devices so that it can decide I can run the Wi-Fi test and the screen test simultaneously so that it's not, because they use different devices, but I won't run the accelerometer test and the screen test at the same time because they use the same device.
All right, so the question is largely, how does Xclave handle parallelization, things that don't use the same device? And the answer is, right now, there isn't any. However, the tests, actually every single unit file in Xclave has a definition that looks looks a lot like systemd. And so I could see, systemd is very good at parallelizing things, and I could see coming up with a similar mechanism to do parallelization. We already have dependencies, so one thing must come up before another thing. I could see us also coming up with conflicts, for example, where these two packages these two unit files cannot be run at the same time. So currently, we don't have a way to do that, but it is not outside of the scope of Xclave to actually do that.
So these are factory tests on unpackaged boards. If you were doing RMA testing for units that came back failed, you'd maybe take a different approach. You could unpackage them, or maybe you'd want to go in through the connectors like the $1 million box.
That's correct. For RMA devices, it's not a thing that we've had to deal with because in our volumes and our sizes, the cost of shipping it back is generally less than the cost of a brand new product. So RMA testing is not the sort of thing that I've done. But you're right. So for example, I mentioned earlier that OpenOCD was a test. There is a concept of a test providing another test. So in the Tomu jig, there is a test called Tomu SWD. And that is particular to that particular jig, and it provides SWD. So you might have another jig separate that also provides SWD, but it might go through a different pin. And so on a different jig that might be the special RMA jig, it would have a set of tests that does that. Might even be the same set of tests, but because a different thing is providing this SWD, it is able to go through that. Or I know a lot of, for example, Freescale chips, they have a special set of registers. They have an unlock RMA key. Perhaps one of those, perhaps it is a dependency on that jig to write those unlock RMA keys before it executes the rest of the tests. So it just becomes a dependency problem at that point for RMA boards.
All right, so we've run out of time for questions, but I'm sure Sean will stick around to answer any if you have any. But can we all thank Sean for his and on behalf of the Linux Honor guys,
thank you.